Hello and welcome to our today's webinar session. My name is Martin and I want to welcome all attendees. In a few moments, we want to start with our presentation. During the presentation, you can use the chat box functionality of GoToMeeting to ask any kind of questions you may have during the presentation. And our today topic is the World Restore Day. The idea is behind in critical businesses, what we want is a working and fast disaster recovery. The big first question is, of course, backups. Yeah, the topic backups. Everyone make backups. There's nothing special. Yeah. So yeah, backup. Everyone has a backup. That's important. But we never know when a disaster happens. So that's why we need to be prepared. So that's the first important point, because it can always happen regardless how sensitive and carefully you protected the system before. And hardware problem or a crypto logger attack or whatever can always happen regardless of the security from the local side. So we need to be prepared for a real disaster, and we need to have a working restore and a quick way to recover files and folders, but more important, entire systems within few moments, not hours or days, in a few moments. And this is what we want to talk about in detail right now. So how we have a working and fast disaster recovery solution in a case of emergency. We have a few steps to explain how it works. And of course, first we need to protect our backups. What I said before, crypto locker attacks are a massive problem in IT business. I think it really started around 2 or 3 years ago to have a real pressure on the entire customer environments. And these crypto locker attacks are a huge impact on the productive environments from the end users. So that's why we recommend to have the 3-2-1 backup rule. So the backup strategy is to have at least 3 copies of your backups, and you need to store your copies at least on 2 different storage devices. So for example, you have a local NAS device for the main backup target, and then you have a rotating USB device, RDX device, for a second copy of this image file. And of course, one of these backup copies should be offsite, so that, for example, outside, using replication technology or on rotating hard drives or using FTP or other protocols to a cloud-based storage, whatever you want to use, use it, because to have a safe copy somewhere else is a key point to have your backups protected against like crypto locker attacks. Yeah, that's the very important first point. And we have created best practice guides, white papers for these topics. You get this information afterwards, after the webinar. So we have written and document about that each single scenario. You can check later if you want to have the best practice guide for this scenario to protect your backups against crypto lockers, for example. Yeah, so that's our recommendation. Next important point is, yeah, you need to monitor your backups. So you can use our own monitoring solution, ActiveVisor. So this will always take care what happens with the machines, and it also send you reports about the current state of the local installations, for example. So you also get an information if like an update is enabled or a new machine has been added to the local network which is not protected yet with a backup task, for example. So all this useful information you get by ActiveVisor, which is our main management console. So we always recommend at least per site to install one ActiveVisor to have the full control about the entire local environment. Yeah, That's our recommendation. But you can use, of course, your own monitoring deployment tools. If you use any third-party provider, that's no problem. We are open-minded and we have an open console, so you can read all the informations we create as log files or results with a third-party application without a problem. So, for example, Windows event logs and other information we are storing in a format which can use every single console which offers monitoring. Yeah, if it can read Windows event logs, no problem. You can read also our task and results without any issue. But we recommend, of course, use at least our own solution to monitor and deploy your installations. The major part is test your backups. With test your backup, it's not the email you receive, your backup has been created successfully. That's not enough. Even you create a backup file which is readable, yeah, it never tells you is this really usable in the case of emergency. So of course the creation is information that the backup is created, okay, but is the content of the image file fully readable and usable? It's a different story. So the verification process after the backup has been created is a very critical point. It's always recommended and required, I would say, that you also use the verification feature, that you know that the content is readable. And of course, you can, for example, copy files or data to a broken backup target. In the most cases, you don't get an error message. You only get a message when you try to open an image, for example, later. But during the copy process, in the most cases, you don't recognize an error. And then after a half year or something, you need to recover an older image file. And then you get a notification, sorry, can't open the file, it's corrupt. Nobody wants that. That's why verification is required. Then we have here bootability. With bootability, I need to go a little bit in detail. We have a boot check feature. So with this boot check feature, we not only can before verify the content of the image file, we also able to run a boot check. With the boot check, we can boot every created single image file on a different machine. And this within a few moments with our technology, which allows us to boot somewhere, everywhere, and regardless of the size of the image, instantly any machine to verify is the system fully bootable on a different environment. This is a very important information on top to the verification feature, because even a verification can be successfully, you may have on one of 100,000 cases and problem with the partition table, for example. Yeah, if the partition table of a source machine has an issue, the data itself is readable, but the partition table is broken. When the partition table is broken, you have a raw file format. You don't have like NTFS as file system, you have raw, so you can't use the system. So even you recover such an image, you get a result of a non-usable system, and nobody wants that in emergency. That's why the boot check, which can run even a full restore test, like booting up an image anytime, that's useful and important information. And this can be done automatically using our software. So to summarize, creation, verification and boot check combined is important for the backup testing, and it's automated. You don't need to run manually something. It's an automatic process, and this saves time and money. Yeah, so backup testing is a key point. But what happens when you got an information that the boot check, for example, has been failed, but your source machine is running fine? So in this scenario, we can manually check what is the error, for example. Yeah. So if boot check send you a notification, the task has been failed because of this and this reason. This is just a summary. The real detail why it's failed, you can't detect with automation. That's not possible. There's so many different things can happen that the system is not usable. So that's why we have the image boot feature, which uses the same technology as the boot check feature. The only difference is here you run it manually, so you can see by your own eyes what happens with the machine, to see, for example, the error code of the booting, like a blue screen or an broken boot table or whatever error, or the machine can't start because it's not compatible to the hypervisor or whatever reason. So many different reasons can happen why a system is not usable. And with the image boot technology, you can just select one of the image files, boot it up, and check what is the problem. So you are prepared before something goes wrong, what you may need to know about this machine in a case of emergency when you want to try to run it on a different environment. Because you know, I need to disable first the driver, then the system is bootable, or I need to take care only this and this hypervisor supported, or whatever. Yeah. So with this information and the automatic boot check feature and this manual verification, after you got a failure, you know exactly what's wrong. And that's important. That's with the backup testing and key point. Yeah, and it doesn't take so long because you just choose the image from a NAS, for example, and boot it up on a normal working machine. You don't need the server or the same space like the source machine. You don't need the same memory. It doesn't matter. We don't need performance for these steps. We only need a machine which is able to run our image boot software, and that's it. And that's an important point for your backup testing. You can do the same also with offsite replicated image files. So imagine locally, like here in this example, you have your backup stored on a NAS device. Then you're using our image center to replicate like to rotating hard drives, like here's this RDX or USB devices, or you use an FTP replication to a different site. So on whatever site later you store or copy the data from the local backups, you can run everywhere, anytime, image boot on the machines. Yeah. So like on my own machine, I have a laptop machine here in my office in the meeting room, and I can show you right now how it works. It's so simple. So using image boot is not complicated. Just open it. Image boot, I already installed it on my machine. And now we can start and use our instant boot ability. So first thing, of course, we need to choose the image file you want to test. So I choose my image file. And I have a couple of different image files here stored. So I can choose any of my image files. So I choose my Server 2016 backup. I need to enter my password. And now this is just a preview of the content of the image files. So I have a disk 0, which is my boot disk, and a data disk. When I click next, we mount the image file, but not only a simple mounting, we attach them as a real disk. So our technology with image boot allows us to instantly add any image, regardless of the size, regardless of the source, and regardless of the kind of architecture. And then we can instantly boot on a different hardware anytime within few moments. So in my example, on my own working machine is a Windows 8 professional environment. So I just enabled Hyper-V in Windows programs and roles. And you can also use a Windows 7 machine with VMware Player installed. It doesn't matter. Yeah. So in my scenario, I just enabled Hyper-V on my Windows 8 professional machine. And now I can instantly boot up my backup file. from my server 2016, which comes from a physical server. So for testing, of course, I don't need a network adapter. So I just boot up the machine. So now only with read-only access, so your source image file doesn't get touched or changed, we instantly booting now the image file, and then we can check what happened. Yeah, because before you got a boot check information notification, boot verification last night has been failed, timeout. So now you can check why it has been failed or you got the timeout. Yeah, and this is a good thing because it doesn't take long, just a few moments, and then you can start up the machine. So that we can use the machine on different environments, of course. In the background, our software is now adding drivers to the machine that we can start it on a different environment. And this is always automatically done. And then we boot up the machine and we can check what happened. And the good part is, as I said, your source image is not changed. The real source target machine is still running fine and making backups. So no problem during the productive in working time, for example, you can just open your machine and then you have it here. Yeah, so instantly booted my 2016 server backup, regardless of the size. And that's a very important and nice feature. So that's what I want to show. It's so easy. You can use it like on almost all systems. At least Windows 7 or newer is required to run image boot. But your backups, of course, can be much older, like from a Windows XP or Server 2003 machine. It doesn't matter. You can also boot this old kind of machines without a problem on image boot. Yeah. So that this is what I want to show for the manual backup testing to verify if you got the notification because the boot check, for example, has been failed. So, and of course, all this useful information we have summarized in a white paper. So, of course, you get it also from us that you can have the white paper to check again what are the settings we recommend, what is important to know, and so on. So, of course, we have also the white paper for you prepared to have a read afterwards if you want. This is an interesting point. An entire restore. We always talk about automatic process, quick, and so on. Yeah, that's one point, of course. But it also makes sense to offer separate services to the users, like a complete synthetic full restore test, like a bare metal recovery. We always talk here about virtualization and creating VMs, but what is about a real bare metal recovery? To have a temporary failover to a virtual machine is okay, but in some scenarios, it makes more sense to have a bare metal recovery for the client. So that's why it's in such environments a good idea to run a full recovery test like once a year or every 6 months. Yeah. So with this additional service, of course, you need the manpower, you need the time, you need to have the hardware and so on. But this additional service is for more security because you can test is the disaster recovery plan really working well for this client, and you have a protocol at the end to capture the time that it requires or any problem you may be found during the testing of the restore. This is just an additional idea to offer service. It's not required, but it's a good idea for a few scenarios that make sense, yeah, to run it at least once a year, a full restore test. Yeah, that's a good thing you can offer as additional services. But the real important point to have a valid disaster recovery plan for your clients. That's why we need to concentrate first. What is the key of a good disaster recovery plan? So we have it split off into four groups, and I want to explain each single step by step. Yeah, objective. We need to set the right objective. When we look here at this timeline, I want to explain how it normally works with the idea about a disaster recovery plan. So imagine the office started at 8 a.m. in the morning, it's working fine, and then at 11 a.m. we got a CryptoLocker attack, and now all data is encrypted and the client is lost. He can't continue working and we have a problem. So in this scenario, we need to talk first about the RPO, which is here on the list every 30 minutes. So what is behind the RPO? So with RPO, we talk about recovery point objective. So the idea is this is the time between the last backup and the disaster. So in my scenario, the longest interval would be like 30 minutes of data loss. And you can, of course, increase the interval that you only lose 10 or 15 minutes of data, depending on your client. So this is just an example. I know a lot of users can only take once an hour, every 2 hours. But of course, if you can go more often, then please go for it. It's better. So the next important point is, of course, RTO. And with RTO, we talk about recovery time objective. This is the time after the disaster happened and the recovery process. So in my example, it exactly takes 1 hour. And of course, why it's not all? No, it's not all. It's take much longer because after a successfully recovery, you may need to adjust some other things on the machine, like after the machine has been recovered successfully, it's not booting, or you're booting, but you get a blue screen, or the machine has been started without the error, but your database is not connecting and your Exchange server is not running, whatever. So we have additionally the VRT, the work recovery time, and with work recovery time, we talk about the amount of time you require to adjust and correct problems after a recovery. So in this scenario, this took additionally 30 minutes. So our total time for a really successfully restore and disaster recovery, it took 1 hour and 30 minutes. So it's not about only to talk about restore itself and it's working. It's also the time you may require to adjust or correct problems. And a small thing which happens always, for example, is like when you do a bare metal recovery to new hardware and you have no error at all. You can boot the machine, no problem. But do you know what? When you start on a new hardware, Windows first time, Windows detect new hardware. And of course, if you talk about network cards, you have no static IP address properly entered to the new hardware. So all your application servers, database servers, which rely on static IP address configuration, will get problems. So you also need to adjust this issue. And this takes time. And this is what I want to explain. So with the MTD, which is the sum of RTO and VRT, this is the maximum tolerable downtime. And this is the summary of both of these processes like RTO and VRT. And this need to be considered on planning for disaster. Yeah. So I hope this makes sense to understand what is all about disaster recovery and the right objectives for the users. So after we clarified the idea, we need to set up the priority for all the single environments, because we don't want to use the same RPU, RTO and so on all the systems, because we want to say major server, for example, of course, high priority, and the workstations or the SYN clients or the desktop machines. It's not the issue when this machine is for time down, longer time down. The server is the heart of the company and needs to be run always. So that's why we can define for each single machine, even on-site and off-site location separately. And it makes sense to have a table and an overview, because the business critical machines need to be protected carefully, not the not important client machines, for example. Yeah. So we need to prioritize each single system. When we talk about the correct strategy for disaster recovery, we have here the summary of the topics we have talked before. So you see, all single point is important to take care for a really nice and working disaster recovery in a case of emergency. And we always talked about technical things and software and what we need to prepare. But one major point which is still missing is the people behind. So when we organize the emergency, we also need to talk about the people, the persons which are involved in the disaster recovery plan, like the contact person for the local end user, which may allow us to some specific locations to access, because it's secured by a key. So you need the key, and you need to know which guy can provide us the key. Or when we talk about software, and a third party provider is managing a database on the client side, you don't have access to the specific database or the knowledge, then you need also to invite this guy or this company for the case of emergency. You need always the contact details about all these different persons and people which are involved in the disaster recovery plan. So that's why we recommend to create a table which include external or internal people. And also we need to have an replacement in a case of emergency. So if the main person we need to contact for the database, for example, is maybe sick or not available for whatever reason, so we need to have a colleague to reach in a case of emergency to help us. Yeah. And all this information and contact details should be noted in the disaster recovery plan as well. Yeah. That's also an overlooked thing in the most scenarios, because the most people talk only about the software, how to configure the software, but it's more than just to configure the software properly. You need to have all the people invited and available if somewhere or if something happens in future with the clients. So that's a very important point. And of course, this useful information we have summarized on a template for you. So you can use this as a checklist and like the template for your own disaster recovery plan. And you can feel free to use it anytime for your clients, or you can modify it if you want, no problem. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask. I hope this overview gave you a rough idea what we want to show with the World Restore Day. So how to have a working and quick restore in a case of emergency, what steps are required to be prepared. So if you have any questions, please let me know. Anyway, I want to thank you to all attendees for your time. And if no questions left, I wish all of you a great day and, of course, happy Easter and a good time. Thank you.